Hello, Film Banter fans. How are you doing today?
Hello, Film Banter fans.
We're back for episode 13.
Yes, we are. Episode 13. The unlucky 13.
It'll be lucky for us, though.
You think?
Because I don't believe in superstition, dude.
All right. No, I do sometimes.
You do sometimes.
I do sometimes.
All right. Well, not tonight, hopefully.
Okay, so who are you now?
Well, you know what? I'm going to say that tonight my name is Jack Offener. And you're Mr. Okay. Phil McCracken? Is that what
that
your name
is? That is my name, Phil McCracken.
Yeah, that's a good, pretty good name for you.
Okay, I thank you.
You look like a Phil.
And I've had my McCracken filled.
You have.
There you go.
Yes.
But anyway. I really haven't had my McCracken filled.
I would hope
I just
not.
Want to tell you all of those.
Save that for confession. Don't
folks.
Tell me.
Okay, so you've seen a new film.
I have seen a good film that I want to tell you about. And I want to tell all of you about it. And of course, that's the new film that opened up last weekend.
Perhaps we should tell them who we are and what we do. Not who we are. We've already told them that. But this is Film Banter.
This is
our little hour show. We are an hour long, if I may say. Forgive me for interrupting you.
I don't mean to do that. It's okay.
But we are an hour long, and we hope you can stay and endure it for the entire hour. That would be wonderful.
Usually they do, and I hope that continues.
We don't have our little piece of tape this week.
Oh, we'll ignore it.
We're just going to have to ignore it. We're going to have to not pay attention to how many people don't give a shit about us.
It's fine.
Okay, so there you go. And right now,
okay. Well, I'm glad we got that over with.
Okay, so your first film, Mr.
My first film
Mr.
is
Hoffner.
Yes, is Miss Sloane, the new film with the lovely Jessica Chastain in
she
the lead
lovely.
Role.
She is lovely.
And
who else is in it?
Well, the film also has a very fine supporting cast. We have Mark Strong, who I really always love. He's a great addition to any movie he's in.
Mark Strong.
British actor, bald, very imposing voice. He was in that movie you love, The Brothers Grimley. He was the brother.
Oh, yes.
Of Sacha Baron Cohen.
I love Mark Strong.
Yeah, he's great.
Yeah, he's very good.
This film also features a young actress named Allison Pill, who I know from The Newsroom, which is a fantastic show.
Okay.
You might know her from, she was in Milk, the Harvey Milk film.
Oh, okay. Well, not
she was,
so many years
she
ago.
She had like a red afro in that movie. She was one of the young characters with glasses.
She a black lady?
Yeah. No, she's a young, white girl.
Okay.
Anyway, she's been in a bunch of other films.
There you go.
The film also stars John Lithgow, who plays a senator in this film.
John.
We have Sam Waterston, who plays...
Not Sam.
Sam Waterston is also a Newsroom reunion because he was also in The Newsroom. Fantastic show on HBO.
Okay.
If anybody hasn't seen it, check out The Newsroom. It's only a 3-season commitment. But that's beside the point.
Wow.
And the film
and
is
of course, it's the Jeff Daniels series on HBO.
Of course, yeah, yes. He plays a fantastic part.
Okay.
Anyway, yeah, so there's another actor in the film I'm forgetting. We have Michael Stolberg, who was on Boardwalk Empire.
Okay.
You know, he's been a ton
insignificant
of
folks. Let's get to the
review. No, he's a very big part in the film.
Oh, is he?
He's got
nobody knows his name.
Well, they know his face.
Okay.
He was the star of A Serious Man.
Do you have a picture of him?
Not yet.
Then it doesn't
remember A Serious Man, the Coen Brothers film? He was the star of that.
Oh,
he's been in a lot of stuff lately.
All right, very good.
Anyway, so for anybody who may not know what the film is about, Jessica Chastain plays a Washington, D.C. lobbyist who is extremely bright. She is determined to win no matter what.
Wow.
She has a very, very intimidating reputation all across Capitol Hill.
Okay.
People fear her. They want her services. People don't want to cross her because the word on the street is that she could pretty much go like this and your career's over. She's very powerful.
Ah.
So the film focuses on her working for this firm. She works for this firm led by Sam Waterston. And eventually a big gun representative comes in. They want her specifically, and the firm obviously, to help them with a campaign to defeat a piece of legislation that they see as infringing on the Second Amendment.
Okay.
Which is something we hear a lot about.
Did you like this movie?
I did. And in my opinion, this is a fantastic film.
Okay.
I was sitting in the movie theater just like... I mean, I love political films anyway.
Okay.
So I might be a little biased, but...
All right.
The theater had a decent crowd for 11:45 matinee.
Huh?
It was, I'd say there was at least, I'm going to say 35, 40 people in there. For, you know,
okay.
not terrible.
All right.
And people were applauding at certain points.
Yeah.
People were really into it, clapping. This
really?
One woman was really into it during a couple moments.
Wow. Did they have her taken away eventually?
They didn't. Yeah. No, they didn't. But, so the film is basically centered on her leaving this firm to go take on a cause, to help work to get the bill, this... Second Amendment bill passed, which you know, it's not something she normally does, right?
Okay.
So it's all
about...
I'm
going to interrupt you just for a brief millisecond. Okay. And just tell, because a lot of people have simply just joined us.
Okay, go
on. Our first film, Miss Sloane, Jessica Chastain.
Jessica Chastain.
This is my co-host, of course, Mr.
Yes. You use your real name.
Jack Offener.
Yes, and you're Phil McCracken.
I'm Phil McCracken.
Yes, he is.
So there you go. Okay, continue.
Thank you, sir. Yes, so basically... I guess the best thing I can say about this film is that this is, as of so far, the role of Jessica Chastain's career.
And that's quite a statement.
She will be nominated for this film.
Yeah.
It's just a commanding performance, as they say. She's fantastic from beginning to end. She is cold as ice. She's calculating. She is driven.
Okay.
And she just sucks you in at every moment.
I hope
on the
she
screen.
I wish
yes.
she would.
I'm sure you do. You guys share the nice red top.
We
there.
Do have the red top. Of yes. course, she's a little bit more redder.
Yeah, she's very. She's actually very. I think it's the fact that she has such red hair that it makes her skin look a lot paler than it does.
Yeah, she does. Look
I don't think she's as pale as she looks in the film, but she's beautiful. She's fantastic.
She is.
And she just chews up the scenery in this movie. She's absolutely fantastic.
So she sucks you in and she chews up the scenery.
I really can't recommend this movie highly enough.
Really.
Even if you're not into political thrillers. See it because it's a performance.
I'm not
film.
So into political thrillers, but
it's great for her performance.
I will watch anything with Jessica Chastain.
She's
I love the woman.
Just brilliant
favorite,
in this
favorite
movie.
Roles by Jessica.
I mean, before this film, I really liked her. She did this movie, an indie film a few years ago that was really good called Jolene. I don't know if you saw it.
Well, that was one of the first films she did.
One
that
of
was
big break
in,
for her.
I believe 97 or 99.
I don't think it was that early. I think it's early 2000s.
It? Yeah, yeah.
We'll have to look it up.
She's quite in the buff in this film.
She
she's
is.
A stripper.
Yeah.
I believe,
and
she's on the pole.
In part of it, she's kind of trying to make her way across America, and she does all different things to kind of make a living, I believe.
Oh, okay, interesting. Yeah, yeah.
She's kind of a free spirit.
That was one of her earliest films.
It really was,
Then
yeah.
she kind of broke through in...
She did. Well, in 2011, she was in about four or five movies.
She was.
Tree of Life was one of them.
Tree of
that
Life,
was a big
course.
Break for her.
Yes, absolutely.
I know in 2010, I think it was, or 2011, she did Zero Dark Thirty, the Catherine Bigelow film.
I love Zero Dark Thirty.
That was a big break for her.
Yes, and also Mama.
Mama was a big film for a big one for you, I know.
I love Mama.
It's a good film.
It's produced by Guillermo del Toro.
It is, yeah, that was a good one.
It's a horror film. I
it
love
is.
The film.
She was in Interstellar a couple years ago, obviously.
She was in Interstellar.
She
also played
a ton
the
of
wife
movies.
In the with the Oscar...
Oh, I was going to get to that, yeah.
Yeah.
She was in A Most Violent Year with Oscar Isaac, a film.
Correct.
I liked the film. You didn't care for
it. I did
much.
Not like the film.
But there is some interesting
dreary
trivia.
And miserable.
Here's some trivia about Jessica Chastain that I think is pretty cool.
Uh-oh.
Now,
she also was in a movie, a two-part film that was done from his aspect and
oh,
her
that's a
aspect.
Great film, yeah.
His
that's
and
a
hers.
Really good film.
Yeah.
That is all the way her film, too.
Correct.
She steals that movie, too.
I believe it's called Her... And him.
Well, yeah, but it's also called The Disappearance of Eleanor Rigby.
Exactly.
And there were two versions, him and her.
Right.
Starring with James McAvoy.
I loved
and
it.
And that was a
so
fantastic
bizarre.
Film.
You've got to see those films.
Yeah,
you've got to
see those films. They're fantastic.
One is from her aspect, so we have, you know, he's kind of
it's
bad
great.
To her, and we don't know why. It's just like real life.
And then you see her version.
Where everybody has the side to their story.
Yeah.
So it's
It's almost
that,
like they're both going to a marriage counselor, and the audience is the counselor, and we get two versions of the same story.
Very
That's
true.
A really good film. Brunch, I'm glad you
it
brought
really
that
is.
Up.
I love that movie.
I watched all three versions in one day.
Oh, really?
When it came on video.
Oh, wow.
Yeah,
and that's
great.
A long film. It's like 2.5 hours.
Yeah, it was a commitment, but I
it
really
was a
enjoyed
long
it.
Film.
And
it reminds me, if I may just say, of Rashomon, which is the an old Akira Kurosawa film from like 1957, and it's such a great little movie, everybody, only because we see at one particular point a woman is raped. So we have everybody at the end of the story tells their version
that's cool.
of the
yeah.
rape.
That's
and
cool.
everybody is different. Everybody
yeah.
has a different outlook and how they saw it. Oh, she was the cause of the rape. No,
yeah.
he was the cause. No. Blah, blah, blah. It just goes on. And it's,
that sounds really interesting.
It is quite
And there's been other films that have done that before, but it's still effective. It's a great
it's
plot
It's very
device.
Effective, yeah, absolutely. And they did that to the extremity
in that film,
in
yeah.
the Eleanor Rigby. Yeah, absolutely.
But yeah, real quick, as I was saying, there was some fun trivia about Jessica Chastain that I was thinking of during the film is that she went to Juilliard with Oscar Isaac, right?
Wow.
So they knew each other from there. But she was able to go to Juilliard due in part, I mean, this is, I don't know if it's in whole, but due in part, at the very least, to a scholarship that was created by Robin Williams, who was a Juilliard grad.
I know, right.
With Christopher Reeve.
Christopher Reeve,
and
yeah,
then eventually,
yeah.
she got to meet Robin, and she personally thanked him for, thank you for creating this scholarship, because I wouldn't have been able to go to Juilliard if not for that.
Amazing,
so that was
amazing.
Pretty cool.
Very true.
So overall, Miss Sloane is just a fabulous movie.
Is this a tense movie?
At moments it is, especially the ending.
It's a drama.
It's an intense drama.
Political drama.
Yeah, it's a political drama.
Okay.
It can be very complicated at times because it's talking about all the inner workings of how you get a bill passed. How many votes do we have? They covered that a lot in The American President in very similar detail.
Okay.
In terms of how many votes do we need? We got to petition this guy. We got to do that.
Michael Douglas film.
Exactly, which I love.
That's
I think
a great
he's,
movie.
In that film, in my opinion, he is the best president we've ever seen on film. I thought he played a
you
great role.
You
like
him better than Kevin Kline and Dave?
That was fun, too. Those are the top two, I think.
I like this. I like Kevin also. I thought Michael Douglas was very good.
Yeah, I agree.
Of course. And he was right off the heels of his Wall Street...
It was a few years later. Wall Street was like 87. American President was like 95.
Oh, okay.
But nevertheless...
True. Okay.
But anyway, yes. The final verdict, Miss Sloane, 4-star film. Directed by the great John Madden, who's done a lot of good films, including Shakespeare in Love.
All right.
The score.
Wasn't he in a football announcer?
No, that everybody gets them confused. John Madden is a different. That's a different John.
No,
Madden.
I know it's not really him.
This John Madden is actually British. This John Madden.
Oh, okay.
Anyway, 4-star film. All the way fantastic. Great performances throughout. She. It's her movie. I'm just going to say there's one other point I wanted to make about this film.
Okay.
Like I said, even if you don't like political movies, I think this is a worthy time to go see.
All right. Very good.
Because you're going to hear a lot about it come Oscar time.
Is this a big screen film?
You know,
do you need to see this in the theater?
Only if you want to be in the conversation come Oscar time.
Okay.
Otherwise, you could certainly watch it at home and have the same impact.
Okay.
But the ending of this film is mind-blowing.
Really?
That's just going to say. Ending. You're just sitting there, oh my God, this ending is so great.
All right.
That's all I'm saying.
Oh,
there's no spoilers in what I just said.
All right, no, there's not. Absolutely true.
So,
all right, I'm going to take it now.
4 stars. And on to you.
All right. I'm going to now review Manchester by the Sea, which has gotten a lot of press, a lot of hype,
I'll quick interject, if people didn't catch us last week, I reviewed this film last week.
He did indeed.
Absolutely adored it. Oh no, maybe it was 2 weeks ago. I reviewed it. Was it last? No, it was last week.
No, it was last
week. Because
I
did that and Nocturnal Animals.
Because it had just come out.
Correct.
And you did both.
Manchester.
Films on the same
show. Manchester's going to be one of the best picture nominees as well.
It will be indeed.
And
I was watching the Critics' Choice Awards the other night.
Yes.
Manchester was nominated. I think Jessica was nominated for Miss Sloane.
Okay, I think she was too.
But the winner. Who was
Casey Affleck? Did he win for that?
Casey Affleck did win Best Actor.
He might win the Best Actor this year.
He probably is going to. I think this is Casey's Oscar time.
Yeah, I think so too.
I'm now going to begin my review of Manchester by the Sea.
Please
now,
do.
Now, I'm going to say this.
Remember, no spoilers.
No spoilers. I'm going to begin with an author that maybe you've all heard of. His name is Jerzy Kosinski. And Jerzy Kosinski wrote a book many years ago, probably back in the 40s or 50s. I don't think it was 60s. I think it was a little earlier than that. But he wrote a book called The Painted Bird. The Painted Bird is so depressing. We see a guy literally all through the book. He walks out. His dog is killed. He gets on a thing. His carriage turns over and the horses are all killed.
Okay.
His family members die one by one. We just have a horrible, depressing thing. The end of the book, I believe he kills himself.
That's awful.
And Jerzy Kosinski, in real life...
Killed himself
by putting a plastic bag over his...
That's an awful way to kill yourself.
Over his head. Well, it's where you breathe in your own carbon monoxide.
Awful.
And you die.
Yeah, awful.
And, Manchester by the Sea, for me, was almost on the same caliber of just, I'm going to review this movie on two different levels. I'm going to review it as a film.
Correct.
As the making of a film.
I understand.
It's very well done. The acting, superb. Everybody in this film. I love Michelle Williams. Never given a bad performance.
No, she's
watched her again
too.
Not long ago in my week with Marilyn. She played Marilyn Monroe to perfection. Of course, a lot of people forget she was in Brokeback Mountain with her boyfriend, lover. Heath Ledger, who sadly enough died not long after
Way
that film
young.
Came out. Yeah, but anyway, Manchester by the Sea for me was... now, I have had a tragedy in my life as a few years ago. I lost my wife. I've mentioned that. And I bring up that personal detail because watching Manchester by the Sea for me was not a fun thing to do.
Mm-hmm.
It was depressing. It's not a happy movie.
No, it's not.
I think that, I've seen Casey Affleck in many films now. I recently saw him. He was in the film that Chris Pine was in. The one where they do this incredible heroic rescue.
Oh, yeah, the one with the Coast Guard rescue from, like, the 40s.
What's the name of that movie?
Yeah.
We should know
Bravest,
that.
Not Bravest Hours.
Finest Hours. Finest Hours. There we go. Finest is, of course, a slogan that FDR used. This is our finest hour.
Finest hour.
That was Winston Churchill.
You are correct. There you go. Churchill.
Manchester by the Sea. It's a very well-made movie. It's there's no sheer happiness in this. There's very little humor. There is some humor generated by, there's a young boy in this film. He has some comic moments. This is not a happy film. You're not going to leave the theater wanting to have sex with your mate, whoever you came with. Chances are you're just going to want to go home and be in a somber mood.
Well, I don't know. I think it depends on the person, because I didn't feel that way when I left.
Oh, really?
Okay. No, my girlfriend and I went and saw it, and we left the theater.
And did you go home and have rabid sex after you saw the film?
I think we went to go eat a lot of food.
Obviously. Oh, there you go. It's not a happy movie.
We discussed it for about an hour.
Okay, yeah, it's a disgusting film. No, it's a disgusting film.
I know what you're saying.
I didn't love this movie, but I cannot fault any of the performances. I love Casey Affleck. I think that this is more closer. You know, Casey Affleck is generally Casey Affleck on screen. I've seen Casey on talk shows.
Mm-hmm.
He's the same low-key, somber,
he definitely
very low-key kind of guy. Talks kind of slow, doesn't say a lot, talks only when he needs to talk. This character was made for him.
Yeah, he was perfect.
Because it truly embodies the essence of who Casey Affleck is on a very dear level.
Yeah.
And that's a compliment. It's your personality to a T. Mrs. Doubtfire comes to mind.
Of course.
Or, you know, just various films that we see people that are so much the character of what they're portraying that it's almost unfair.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the beauty of Laurence Olivier, of course, or Larry Oliver, as many people call him.
Mm-hmm.
Larry used to take on a lot of Shakespeare and things and really become a character so forth. And great actors do that. And I think Casey is a great actor, but I don't think that this particular performance is a far stretch for him. I think it's very close to who he is, and therefore he embodies it beautifully.
Mm-hmm.
But as I say, it's almost an unfair film for him to be judged upon. But such is life. We're all judged. All actors are being judged, whatever Oscar roles they mm-hmm. are doing at the time. Yeah. This just fit Casey like a glove, damn it. So did I love this film? Beautifully made, as I say. I mean, there's just some... there's tragedy in this movie, no question about it. I can't say that I love the film only because of the tragedy. Just was almost amazingly, we kind of go from one tragedy to the next. But it certainly deserves your watching, and it's very much a critical darling right now.
It is.
So I think that you owe it to yourself to probably see this film, but. But just be forewarned, it's not for everybody. Don't bring any kids to see this movie. I don't even know what the rating
is. I don't know. It's R. I don't see why you would bring a kid to this movie.
Yeah, you wouldn't want to bring a kid.
Honestly, I don't even think there's a lot of people in their 20s who would want to see this movie.
Don't bring your pets to this either, because it's just sad. This movie is sad, 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 sad.
However, I will say that there is a place in our society for sad films, because...
There's a place for us.
Yes, because life is sad. I mean, sometimes you're going to get kicked in the ass by life, and so this is a representation that maybe to some... might be therapeutic. Maybe somebody who's been through something similar could say, hey, well, you know.
I have to disagree with you, sir.
I don't know.
Well, because life is, as Alfred Hitchcock said, and I've repeated this on this show, that movies are real life with the dull bits left out. Well, this movie pretty much leaves the dull bits in. I think real life has a tendency to be, in my humble opinion, and I am a little older than you, but I'm old enough to be your uncle, damn it. And
my father.
But possibly possible. But anyway, this film is just, I totally lost track of where I was going. So
you were saying that you didn't necessarily...
I'm just human here.
You didn't agree with me that some people could find this film
therapeutic. Oh, yes. I don't think it would be therapeutic because I don't think real life is like what this film is. This film is like a Jerzy Kaczynski novel.
Yeah,
it's sad.
Have you looked at some people's lives? I mean, what they've been through?
Yes, but every day we have ups, we have downs. We as a human race.
Yeah.
We just do. We, you know, we'll do something stupid, then we'll watch some stupid cat video on YouTube that's hilarious.
Yeah, but they're not going to put that in this film. There's none of that in this film.
No, they're not going to put cat videos in this film, I agree. Although I wish they would have.
Yeah.
But anyway, regardless, Manchester by the Sea, I do recommend you seeing it, but... and don't be anywhere near any sharp objects when you come out of this film, because I don't want anybody slicing their wrists or their...
I don't think anybody is going to
do that. I did want to take my popcorn container and just put it over my head and suffocate myself after I saw this movie, because it's a tough one to watch. And with that, last week I reviewed a film. Okay, my recommendation, yes, you should see Manchester by the Sea. It's a critic's darling.
But see it with caution.
Yeah, see it just knowing that you're going in, and you know what? Most of you are just going to say, I don't want to see no dad movie. I'd rather go see The Office Christmas Party. Yeah. And you know what? I don't blame you.
You know, I was almost going to see that tonight after our show.
I was almost going to see that,
but
too.
But I decided that I'm not going to go because the only time that would work was like a 10:40 in the reserved seating only, which is extortive. It's
$23. Where's that at?
Garden State Plaza, Paramus.
Well, let's go over to the Nanuet Theater and see it. I'll go with you
No, my buddies and I were going to go.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, we're not
going to go. All right.
No, but I'm not going to spend that to go see Office Christmas Party.
Neither here nor there, sir. Well,
I'm seeing Rogue One this week, though.
I am, too.
Rogue One review next week.
There we go. You'll be also excited.
When are you going?
Rogue One? I'll go Thursday night.
That's when I'm going.
I always go Thursday night. Yeah, I just get there. I get like a 10:30 show. And
I'm going.
Whatever.
I'm doing IMAX at 10.
Now, these are things you can't relate to, but it means a lot to us. But we should be talking about that stuff off camera, perhaps. So let's move right into our next review. Last week I reviewed a movie with Noomi Rapace, who is the girl in the dragon tattoo.
Right?
No, it's Rapace, I believe.
No, R-A-P-A-C-E is the spelling. Wouldn't that be Rapace?
Rapace. Okay, Rapace.
I don't think the E would be pronounced. Rapace, Rapace?
Perhaps Rapace.
It's Swedish, so I don't know how they say
potato,
things over there.
Potato.
I know her first name is Noomi. It's pronounced Noomi.
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 I'm pretty sure.
Noomi.
You know me?
I like Noomi.
I know
you.
You know me?
Yeah. Noomi.
All right, what's your review of that film? Recap.
Well, Rupture, I thought, was a totally bizarre, off-the-wall film. I loved it in all of its... It's a kind of a bizarre, off-the-wall, kind of sick movie. And poor Noomi Rapace, however you say her name, really had to endure hell and high water in the making of this film. No question about it.
I agree with you there.
It's a tough movie to watch. It's a tough movie to get through. It is, in fact, a horror film, but... it has a reality aspect to it where it could, in fact, happen if we are, in fact, invaded by a race of people. But I don't want to give anything away now.
No. But, because I guess I'll jump in, unless you're not done yet.
Well, I just want to pass the baton over to Mr. Hoffner, Mr.
Yes.
Jack Hoffner.
Yes, because last week I hadn't had a time.
Had not had a chance to see it. I did review it last week.
Yes.
And... I love this movie? I didn't, but I was enraptured by it.
It's a good way to put it.
There you go.
Yeah, well, I'm going to agree with you because I watched it as well.
Continue talking, sir.
Okay. Oh, all right.
Go ahead.
Anyway, so Rupture, it is a very, very... Oh, my goodness. Somebody's phone is ringing here. Yeah, it's a very soothing ring, I must say.
I love it.
What is that?
It's a guitar solo.
From what, though?
I don't know.
Oh. Well, I'm going to wait till it's done.
It will go one more time.
I know. I can tell. Go again.
All right, so continue talking. Go ahead, Rupture.
I don't want to talk over the music.
Oh, I'm terrible.
I'm frankly enjoying it. I like that.
Oh, okay.
I like that riff.
I'm glad. Okay, I enjoy it myself.
I'm going to hold this because I don't want it to fall over.
I'm not even gonna look.
Okay.
But I'll turn this
sorry,
thing
that was a dog related
I
incident.
Do apologize, yes.
Okay, so Rupture, yes. As Daryl has eloquently said, it's a very, very, very intense, horrific film. It reminded me, you know, there's elements of Saw, obviously, that people would compare it to. There's elements of Lynch thrown in there. There's tons of movies we can pull from. But as a film itself, without
it's a horror film,
without
no
comparing it, it's a horror film.
Yeah.
It's an abduction story. You know, she plays a mother, a single mother, who when she drops her kid off to the father for the weekend, she gets abducted with some people who have an agenda. And so she's held captive in this, like, cavernous compound in the middle of nowhere.
Well, it's a surgical facility.
Well, I was going to get to that. There are surgical suites all over the place, but also they're like a cell with these ultra-secure locked doors with a computer readout screen.
Yeah.
It's just, like, crazy. She's handcuffed to the bed on both feet and legs shackled. When she first gets abducted, they knock her out with a taser, and then they cover her entire face, except for her eyes, with duct tape almost.
Plastic.
Yeah, it's like a plastic tape. Electrical tape, yeah. And so she's just put through hell from the beginning to the end.
True.
You know, and eventually she's shackled, and they have some things that they do to her that I was squirming in my seat that I hope
so
was
hard
CGI. Because I didn't see that coming.
Yeah.
I didn't see anything coming.
I know. The end of this film,
when things are revealed,
is truly a shocker. Yeah.
I never would have expected what is revealed to be what was going on.
And that is a tribute to the writer of this film for just taking and giving us something
totally new. Yeah.
I've never seen before in any kind of a horror essence.
Yeah.
And well, now listen, folks. We're talking about Rupture here is the name of the film.
Check it out.
I think you said Rapture earlier.
No, I said Rupture.
Did you say
it's Rupture?
Okay. It is Rupture. Yeah. Now, where you're going to find Rupture, that's the key question here. I found it kind of in cavernous hidings within the internet, which are possible to do.
Yes.
I don't know if this movie is available on Amazon or such.
Well, it might even be playing in very, very, very limited release,
too. No, it's not playing anywhere, dude.
Dude,
maybe
it's not
LA.
Playing anywhere.
I'll have to look. Maybe
it's not
LA.
Playing anywhere, man.
Hey, man, how do you know?
It's not. I just know it's not.
But yes, Rupture is a very fucked up movie.
Very gruesome film.
It is fucked
from the director
up,
of the from the director of the film Secretary, which was
that's right.
a Maggie Gyllenhaal film and
Maggie
James Spader.
James Spader, motherfucker. Yeah.
So yes, Rupture. I would say I definitely recommend it.
I
check it out.
It too. I'm glad you liked it. I'm glad you liked
it. It is a head fuck, as you can
say. It is a mind fuck. No question about it. This movie is. It's tough to watch. It's a strange, invariable, a weird.
It's a squirming kind of
zone.
Film. And I must say, Noomi gets an applause.
Oh, God.
Everything she went through
in
this film.
Oh,
it reminded
man.
Me of Alison Lohman. Alison Lohman? Whatever her name was. I think it's Alison Lohman that was in Drag Me to Hell, and what she went through in that film.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
Another great film. That was a Sam Raimi movie.
It was a Sam Raimi film.
But anyway, Rupture, check it out.
A very bizarre film.
Yeah.
And, you know, we were talking about the series Black Mirror.
Yes.
Which is available on Netflix.
Correct.
And I almost felt, as I said to you last week, that Rupture almost felt like one of those episodes. Elongated, but of course there was no media involved within the Rupture aspect. But just the wacko bizarrety of Rupture, it kind of falls into that very strange Twilight Zonian world that Black Mirror really encompasses.
And we're going to touch on Black Mirror a little bit more in depth in a little bit.
If we have time, we will.
I hope we do, because I really want to.
Okay, so you liked Rupture, though.
I did.
Yeah.
I thought it was good. I'm glad I watched it.
Would you show this movie to your girlfriend?
Well, I wouldn't, only because that's not her genre. She doesn't like those kind of movies. Really.
Yeah, yeah. It's
I kind of told her
to
all about it today, and she was like, ugh.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not for the squeamish. It's there's a lot of there's a lot of stuff that's so wacky.
I'll say she probably watched this though before Love Actually, which is I've been trying to get her to watch.
Really?
I can't get her to watch Shawshank.
What's wrong with
Love
Actually?
She said she doesn't care for a lot of the actors.
It's like the greatest Christmas movie of all time right now.
I'll say the one thing about her, it's actually a compliment, is that she likes a lot of kinds of stuff that most women don't like.
Yeah.
So that's to her credit. Like, she loves Star Wars. She loves anime. She loves sci-fi and superhero movies. Whereas, you want to put on a romantic comedy, she, like, shudders. You know?
Okay.
Well, no, but Love Actually, I think, is above all those
kind
of movies.
She's more like a dude, is what you're saying.
In terms of taste of movies, correct.
There you go. All right.
That's
Kim,
beside the point.
If you're out there, we love you. We're
we
just
do.
Talking about your taste.
We talk about you a lot because you're a big part of our lives.
His life.
My life.
Well, not much of my life.
Well, you hear about
I
you.
I know of you.
You ask her about you. Ask about her often, and you.
I do indeed.
You care. You
no,
met
I
her.
Do care. I met her. I like her very
we
much.
We came over here together to watch a film.
You did indeed.
Do you remember
what
movie
we
watched?
Movie you watched?
Was it? Did we watch The Nice Guys? What did we watch together?
We watched The Nice Guys.
We did. I thought
we
so.
We did, yeah.
Yeah, she enjoyed that.
Great little movie.
A lot of
Russell
fun.
Russell Crowe.
I know we've touched on it
Ryan
in this
Gosling.
Show.
A lot of fun.
It
lot
is
of,
great.
A lot of stuff. It's available at your local Redbox. If anyone can go to Redbox, it's there. I'm now going to intervene here and talk about the film. It's called The Light Between Oceans.
Which I'm really excited to see.
And it is. It stars Mr. Michael Fassbender.
Correct.
Spectacular. And Alicia...
Alicia Vikander.
Vikander, who just won an Oscar for
last year.
The Danish Girl with Lydia, little Eddie Redmayne, who kind of goes a little...
Redmayne.
He just goes a little... Redmayne. He goes
whatever.
A little... you know, he wants to be a woman. And he wants to be alone, is
he
what Marlene Dietrich just once said. Or was that Greta Garbo? I'm not sure anymore. I want to be alone. But anyway, The Light Between Oceans, this is a strange little tale. It is about a couple. We go through the whole mating process, the courtship process of Michael Fassbender. He moves to a very small town. I'm not sure what country we're in here.
Isn't it like Northern Ireland or something?
Probably is Northern Ireland. Yeah,
like
Northern
that.
Ireland, Scotland. One of those.
Somewhere with some highlands with a lighthouse.
One of those bloody islands over there, you know.
Yeah.
But so. Michael moves there. He is a lighthouse keeper. He falls in love with Alicia, and she is the daughter of a family that he visits from time to time that he knows. And they marry, and they try to have children, and they cannot have children. She keeps miscarrying very painfully. And this all happens very soon in the film. I just want to give you a
so this is not a spoiler, really?
Not a spoiler at all. Okay. But she is unable to have children. And then one day, they are literally, he's in his lighthouse. She's very upset. They've just buried their second miscarried child, unfortunately.
Yeah.
It's very sad. I will say right off the bat, Michael Fassbender and Alicia, what's her name again?
Alicia Vikander.
Alicia Vikander. Okay.
Who's also in Ex Machina?
Isn't that a container, actually? Is it a Vikander?
Decanter.
Decanter.
You're thinking of a decanter where you would put wine.
Yeah, there you go. Or there's also a canter. A canter.
Which
is
somebody
like
a
Jewish,
at a church.
Yeah, he's like a Jewish rabbi.
Hand, please, on the mic.
He's like a rabbi, a Jewish guy, yeah. But anyway, he's a rabbi, sort of, a canter. I believe that, yeah, in fact, in...
C-A-N-T-O-R.
Doesn't matter. But anyway, the film is beautifully acted. Michael Fassbender and Alicia Decanter.
Yes.
Decanter. What's her name again?
Vikander.
Alicia
Vikander.
I can't get through that.
Say
it
five times fast.
Alicia Vikander. Alicia Vikander.
Alicia
Vikander. Alicia Vikander. Alicia Vikander. Alicia Vikander. Alicia Vikander. Alicia Vikander.
I'll test you in 5 minutes.
Thank you very much. Well, now I'll never forget it. I love Alicia. She was in El Machina, which is the
Ex Machina.
Ex Machina. Which is a bizarre little...
With Oscar Isaac.
Yeah, it was Oscar Isaac. Once again, she played a half-robot, half-not-robot.
No, a full robot.
Was she a full robot?
That wasn't
a full robot.
Yeah, she wasn't
yeah,
cyborg.
Yeah, that's correct. But she had, like, you know,
well, they had
skin on her
skin
face
on her, yeah, like
so
Westworld,
forth.
That kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And we also go right into Morgan, which I did review a long time ago. I gave you the film to watch. You have not watched it.
Morgan?
Morgan is that new film with...
I don't think you gave me Morgan.
I did give you Morgan.
You did?
It's on that very
I gotta look. I
drive
missed
that
one.
Yeah.
That's the one with the girl. What's her name that you love?
Yeah, yeah. A little, what is her name? And she's got a sister who was in
she
the...
Kate Mara.
Kate Mara.
And Rooney Mara is
Rooney
her sister.
Mara. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
But anyway, getting back to Light Between the Ocean, Between Oceans, it's a very heartwarming film, but okay. She has just given her second miscarriage.
Yes.
And suddenly, there is a small a boat, like a little rowboat, on the horizon.
I
and it
see.
Comes slowly moving up. And what is in that boat but a dead man and a baby?
So it's like Moses.
It's a little baby. It's a baby.
It's a little Moses coming.
It's a little baby, basically. So this is the answer to their dreams.
And of course...
They've been praying for a baby, and damn it, there comes one floating out of the damn ocean. This little baby comes up. It's just a little baby, a tiny little baby, and it's going goo goo ga ga. So they're just thrilled to the gills. And they decide to raise this as their own until they find something has begun to happen. And you have to see this film, but it's a heartbreaker. It is indeed a heartbreaker, and just things go in just the strangest way. I believe this is actually a Nicholas Sparks novel. I could be mistaken.
Could be. I'm checking right now.
I see. I believe reading the IMDb review, they mentioned Nicholas Sparks in it.
Well, it says the novel was by M.L. Stedman.
M.L. Stedman, yeah. Not like E.L. Forrester or somebody.
No, M.L. Stedman.
Okay, yeah. So
And the director is who I thought it was, Derek Cianfrance, who did The Place Between the Pines, and a film that I love, I Blue Valentine.
Oh, okay, two Ryan Gosling films. Yeah,
Ryan Gosling, Michelle Williams.
Right, there you go.
In my opinion, that's my favorite performance by Ryan Gosling.
Really?
He's so good in that movie.
He is good.
If you haven't seen Blue Valentine.
He's also good in Driver, though.
He's good in Drive. Yeah, he's great.
Drive, he is great.
He's really been consistently good.
Yeah, he's nominated in the Critics' Choice Award for La La Land, of course.
Which they say that's going to win Best Picture.
I know.
I didn't see that coming.
I didn't either.
I got to see it.
It's a musical, and it's a fantasy.
And it's got all original stuff, too. It's not based on anything.
Yeah, yeah. True.
All the songs are original. The guy that did Whiplash.
Really?
Damien Chazelle, or whatever his name is, the director-writer. Yeah.
Amazing, amazing.
So
anyway, my recommendation, go see The Light Between Oceans. It's going to be available on video
shortly. Yeah, it's not in theaters anymore.
It's not in theaters. It's more of a masterpiece theater, that PBS kind of film.
Okay.
That kind of we put on and we say, oh, this is too boring. I'm going to change the channel. And you do change the channel.
Is it slow?
It is very slow. Okay. But because of the acting and the content of the film, it's very
good.
Intense.
Well, that'll keep you.
There's an intensity there that, as Jessica Chastain to you, she sucked you in.
Yeah, it's true.
And I wish you would.
What would you say is the slowest film you ever watched?
The slowest.
What was the toughest
film
I ever
watched? So that's almost impossible because there's been a lot of slow films.
I know mine.
I can think of one. There was a movie that I did not like at all. Of course, I can't think of the title of it, but it starred, she was famous. She was in Officer and a Gentleman.
Deborah Winger.
Deborah Winger was in this film, and she was married to a sheik or something like that. Oh, this film was god-awful. It was like 2.5 hours, and I'm going to go into Passage to India, one of David Lean's final films.
Yeah,
that came out in the late 80s. Just horribly, horribly slow. But there's just too many films out there that, you know, it's just as hard to make a bad film as it is to make a good film, because it takes writing, it takes lighting, it takes acting, it takes everyone has to, you know, there's a lot of work to be done to make a movie. And, you know, some people, their vision is different than other people. So it's a tough call on what makes a movie. You know, one man's Beethoven is another man's Johnny Rotten, Sex Pistols. So, you know, it really comes right down to just taste and what interests us.
And that's what's hard to say about a slow film is that, okay, it's slow. It didn't captivate a certain person the way they would have liked. But can you argue that it's a bad film then? And I don't know if you can. I think it's all subjective.
No.
For example, for me, the slowest movie that I can recall, and it was a tough one to sit through, was Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil, Clint Eastwood's film
from
97. It's chock full of amazing actors, and it's a good film,
right.
But it is so damn slow that I never really watched it again. I never wanted to. But it doesn't mean it's a bad
film.
It's worth seeing once.
That's what I've heard.
But don't go to see it at like 11:30 show. That was my problem. It was too late to
see
it. Anyway.
You'll pass right out.
So
you'll wake up with your head in your popcorn.
Exactly.
Snorting butter, you know, and God knows how we've all done that before.
Okay. I don't know if I have.
I don't know if you have.
But let's move on. I'd like to talk about
I'm just going
to
say Light Between Oceans is certainly worth seeing. It's very intense. I love Michael Fassbender. I really do.
The guy's great in everything he's
in. I think he truly is one of our finest actors going right now.
He's right up with
Daniel Day-Lewis, who only makes a movie every 3-4 years now.
Yeah, it's true.
And they have to convince him to come out of retirement to come make the damn film. So in the meantime, we have Michael Fassbender, and I am looking forward, damn it, to the Prometheus sequel by
that's coming out next year.
Convergence, I believe.
It's called Alien Covenant.
Covenant, there you go.
Yeah.
Which is the sequel to Prometheus, which is still the prequel
to the original Alien.
With Sigourney and John Hurt. Yeah.
And I think this one is supposed to take place, I think I heard, 10 years after Prometheus.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Cool.
And I heard Nomi is coming back. Nomi Rapace is back.
Oh, good. Love it.
Yeah.
It. So, Light Between the Oceans, yes, I do wholeheartedly recommend it. I think the standard humanoid will enjoy this film.
Good.
Nobody under the age of, I don't think if you're under the age of 25, you're going to enjoy it too much. But,
no. Well, but, yeah, it's not that kind of.
Yeah, it's not that kind of film.
Unless you're a movie geek.
PBS.
Like us.
It does also star Rachel Weisz, who is,
she's in the film.
Daniel Craig's wife.
Correct.
And she, by the way, good news for all you people. Looks like Daniel Craig may be coming back to do another James Bond.
I think
Bond.
that was all.
I think he truly wanted to get away, but he said as long as I can take a few years, and he is on Broadway
right now
courtesy of
he's doing
Carol
Othello.
Broccoli. Yeah, right. The Broccoli daughter of Cubby Broccoli, who created all the James Bond films. So he's still involved with those people, and there is hope for us. Bond to
file. He's on Broadway now.
He's
on the West End. Is it Broadway or the West End?
I don't know.
But he's doing Othello with
he's
David.
He's in New York.
He's doing. Well, then that's Broadway. He's doing Othello with David Oyelowo, who played MLK.
Oyelowo.
Oyelowo is how you say his name.
Oh wow!
And he was in Selma. He played MLK. He's been in a lot of films.
MLK, Martin Luther King.
Yeah. I think everybody knows what that is.
I don't know if everybody does.
I think most people know MLK.
Do you all know
that
MLK is...
Just like JFK is John F. Kennedy.
Okay. It could be Mulatto's Love Kings. I mean, that's what it could be. It could be,
maybe,
you know...
Anyway, that's who that is.
Milk Likes Cookies, and so forth. But anyway...
My Lovely Kids.
My Lovely Kids, okay.
My Loathsome Kids.
Okay.
My Little Kids.
There you go. All right, we can go on all day.
No, let's not. Let's move on to
something
else real quick.
Okay, so now it is...
Because we are running low on time.
Mr.
So
Jack Hoffner, it is
I'd almost
time.
Say, do you want to jump to Black Mirror a little bit? Or do you want to do one more film? Because
well,
we are running low on time.
You do have this film. We've already... I believe we already reviewed that film.
No, we didn't.
Hardcore Henry?
No. Because that came out before we started doing this show.
Okay.
That came out in like March.
Let's talk about Hardcore Henry.
I
want to
touch
on
a film that I was reminded of yesterday.
Let's just touch on it, though, because it's kind of
I'm talking like 2 minutes.
Okay.
I was thinking yesterday about Hardcore Henry. If you haven't seen it, it was out in theaters earlier this spring.
It was?
I think it was out in March, April. And it is an astounding piece of cinema that will rock you the whole time.
It is all point of view.
It's all first person.
The
whole film is one perspective.
Kind of, it has a video game appeal to it.
It is an impressive feat of stunt choreography and action filmmaking.
Absolutely.
Everything, most of the film, a lot of the times, the stunts are one take. It's just phenomenal to what they were able to achieve. And, you know, the storyline, it doesn't really matter. It's a guy that wakes up and he's trying to figure out, where am I? He's getting amnesia. Who am I? Why do I have these weird abilities to do these kind of things? It seems like he's got some cyborg elements to him.
Right.
And so the whole movie's being chased. And then women come into his life. Different characters come into his life. And one of the running people that come into it is the actor Sholto Copley, who was in District 9. He is a South African actor who was in a couple of the films. District 9, he was in Chappie. And he's one of the stars
of
the film.
A lot of Australian stuff.
South African.
I'm all safe.
He also played Murdoch in the 18 film. Remember 18 that came out with Liam Neeson a few years ago? He played Murdoch.
18?
18. The
18. Oh,
18.
18. Oh, I'm sorry.
And anyway, so he comes into the film in many different forms, almost like he plays multiple characters.
Okay.
But it's just a rock your socks off action movie.
It is.
Rock and roll music from head to toe. It's an extravaganza of action. Check it out.
It is
just amazing.
Indeed.
I didn't want to see it at first. I really didn't.
Yeah.
And I think it was your review that convinced me to see it.
Okay, I saw the film, and I hated every minute of it.
But I thought you praised it in some respects.
The only thing I praised about it was the special effects. It just was so incredibly... It almost
nauseating for you,
it
right?
It was nauseating.
Some people have motion sickness issues.
I did have motion sickness. I couldn't get through this film without literally... I upchucked my milk duds. At least once or twice through the film, it was
that's unfortunate.
My Juji Fruits began to go into a multi.
Your good and plenty became plenty.
A Technicolor display upon the floor.
Yes, you did.
As I tried in vain to watch this film, I didn't love it. Although there was a certain plot element to it that you get kind of caught up to.
Yeah.
It is a good versus evil kind of bullshit.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
Oh man, it was just too much and too much and too much and too much and too much. Did I like this film? I did not really care for Hardcore. Although I bow, and let me bow, if I may. I bow.
Arigato.
Arigato. I bow to, you know, that's my favorite guy. when I go to the Garden State Plaza Theater, right by
He was there today.
There's a wonderful little Japanese man.
Yeah.
And he is the sweetest human being I think I know in my world right
He's great.
Now. He is such a sweet man.
Very welcoming.
And whenever I see him, I always go, yes. And he go, Theater 5, arigato.
Hello, thank you, sir. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, kind sir.
Now, are we sure that he's Japanese?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
Well, because I always say, sayonara. He goes, oh, sayonara.
Oh, you do? Okay.
Sayonara.
Yeah.
Yes, my friend, sayonara. And he pats me on the... Yeah, I love this man. He's just a sweetheart of a guy.
Cool.
And I he always wears a black cap.
And a lot of times he has like a 3D glasses on, so
yeah,
I can't really see
his eyes.
Yeah,
I know. He's just a movie unto his own self.
He's a nice
and
guy.
It's such
though.
A joy to walk into that theater and see that little guy. I wonder what his name is. I'm going to find out what his name is.
It's on his name tag.
Oh,
I never looked at it.
All right.
I should look at it.
It's probably... Who knows what it is?
Sorry, Bruce.
Yeah, something like that.
Bruce Wang.
Yeah, his name is Jack Hoffner, possibly.
Anyway.
But, okay, I'm going to go right into a film that I just recently saw, and it stars...
Dominic Monaghan.
Dominic Monaghan.
Who was in
Lost. The Lord of the Rings.
And
he's
Lord
in
of the
Lost,
Rings.
Lord of the Rings.
Quite
he's
a few things.
He's a squirrely kind of looking little thin face, a small human being. This movie is called Pet. And you're going to find this movie exactly maybe in the same kind of genre world set of angles where you're going to find Rupture at.
Mm.
But it's just a strange off-the-kilter wall. This is definitely a horror film.
Mm-hmm.
This is a stalker movie.
Okay.
This is about a man. He works in a pet. These are dogs that are about to be euthanized.
Oh, a shelter then, huh?
It's a shelter. He has to feed the animals, take care of the animals. He is on a bus one day, sees a girl that he knew in high school, and he basically falls head over heels in a split second for this woman. So he begins to follow her.
So it's an obsession.
He begins to be obsessed with her. And I'm going to go straight for it, folks. I'm going to give away what the premise of the movie is. What he does is he captures her, and he puts her into a cage in the basement of
The pet shop.
Of the pet, no, not a pet shop, but
the shelter, I mean.
The shelter,
yeah,
which is
it.
A big warehouse of a place. Yeah. And they euthanize the dogs. And I'll tell you, I've got dogs. I can't even watch movies with animals in them because I just feel that the animals are not going to be treated right. And I just am a weirdo that way. So I was very upset to see, animals in these little tiny cages that that Mr. Monaghan has to take care of. What's his first name again?
Dominic.
Dominic. God damn. Why can't I remember Dominic?
It's okay.
I don't know. But anyway.
Thank you.
So.
If you fix it easy, you can call him. You can just call him Dom Mon if you want.
Dom Mon Ick. So, but no, it's a strange movie. So he basically, and it reminded me very much so of a film I saw back in the 60s called, a very famous movie with Terrence Stamp, a wonderful actress by the name of Samantha Eggar, called The Collector.
Mm.
He collects butterflies, but he then begins to become obsessed with a woman, and he collects her. He brings her back, puts her in this room, locks her in a door, and she can't get out. Well, in this case, Dominic Monaghan, thank you very much, puts this woman into a cage and gives her a little bedpan that she can pee and
do
her business, her doggy business.
So he treats her like one of his
treats her basically like
pets.
A pet,
right.
But there is a huge twist in this film that I did find manipulative only due to the fact as movies become manipulative because... They want to do something different that's never been done before. So they manipulate we mindless humanoids who sit and watch these films and try and throw something different at us.
Yeah.
And I will say this film kind of succeeded, but at the same time it didn't. We find out a certain particular thing about the girl and she's a very attractive young woman, very attractive in fact, and it's why... we almost become obsessed along with her, and we find out various things. It's a real mini horror film.
Mm-hmm.
I enjoyed this film. I did enjoy it.
Cool.
I truly did. And I just, by the way, forgive me, but I thought of the other film that I saw, and I do want to mention briefly.
Oh, okay.
I'll just do it very quickly, if I may. And it's called The Disappointments Room. And this film stars just one of the most beautiful women on our planet. Kate Beckinsale is in this film.
Mm-hmm.
And she plays a woman who, she and her husband, name of the film once again, The Disappointments Room.
Okay.
It's they buy an old house in the country. It's the same old bullshit we see in all horror films. It's the old house in the country shtick that happens to be something else is living in the house. I'm going to tell you one thing right now and here. One of the things I'm getting so tired of in horror films,
yes,
and it busts my balls every time, and I just want to scream, oh, stop it, you fucking stupid director who put that in there. How many times are we watching a horror movie,
yeah,
and what do we see? We see this. We see the person staring out, looking in a mirror, and then behind them we see, whoosh, the figure, the strange creature, yeah, of ghostly, uh-huh, magnitude, run behind them. They turn their head, and now they go whoosh, this way, right? How many times do we see that? It drives me nuts. I can't stand it. I don't want to see it anymore.
Unfortunately, horror, it's a very formulaic genre.
We all know that.
It's terrible.
And what's the worst part is sometimes a director will take the most simplistic thing.
Yeah.
You know, you're sitting at the kitchen table, the dog jumps up on your lap, and the music goes, blunk!
Just to
mess with you, you know?
It's all manipulation.
She walks into the bathroom, and she suddenly sees a reflection in the mirror. Uh-huh. Womp! It's her husband. Oh, honey, you want to get something to eat? But the music goes, womp! You know, and then,
So you didn't care for this film?
Little psycho. No, I liked it a lot.
Oh, you just didn't?
I did like the film. Let me tell you what the Disappointments Room is very briefly. It's a room that was created, and this is the uniqueness of this film. It was a room created back in the early, and I believe this to be true. I don't know why I do. It's probably all BS. But what people used to do, they would have a daughter or a son. This is back in the 1800s. And that daughter or son was deformed or just messed up in a certain way, either retarded,
perhaps. Oh, this sounds horrible. I think we're not where
you're going. Retarded or just deformed. So they would take this child and rather embarrass the owner and wife of the house, and they would put this child in this room, in this attic, and let them stay there so the rest of the world was kept free from having to see that this was a child of this very elite, substantial couple. You know, this guy, the particular man in the Disappointments Room, who, he's like a baron almost. He's a very wealthy plantation owner. And so he keeps his daughter up in this room. And so Kate Beckinsale stumbles into this room. She, you know, it's locked. She finds a box with 30 keys in it. She goes through it and goes through it and goes into the room and is just completely blown away by all the horror that she now sees, that she's now privy to, now that she's stuck in this room. Of course, as soon as she walks in the room the first time, slam, the door slams shut, and she's stuck there. And I'll tell you, there are some definite frightening moments of this film. It did definitely stick in my head, and I like this film. I love horror movies. It's a big genre, close to my heart, and I go for it. So I'm going to pass it over to Mr. Jack Hoffner.
Okay. Well, you know, all I want to do now is I just want to, you know, briefly touch a little bit on Black Mirror, because we've been teasing it all episode, and we are running low on time. But last week we discussed a little bit season one.
Okay.
And you know, I probably would almost prefer to do that, because last week we had some issues with our episode being downloaded into the archive. And it was all the video and the audio, unfortunately, not in sync. So,
please tell the people where they can find Black Mirror.
Yes. Well, you know, if you want to watch Black Mirror, it's simple. Go to Netflix.
That's
you can watch the three seasons there.
Yeah.
It's a very...
It's a British series.
It's a British series. It sucks you in. Each episode is standalone, much like Twilight Zone was.
Right.
The gimmick here is that each story touches on an element of our society, given our obsession with technology and media. And
correct.
There's a sci-fi twist in it in terms of how this particular aspect that they're exploring in this episode could come back to bite us.
Has progressed to,
to a point
very often go into
very dangerous.
A futuristic level of our media, the succubus that is the media devil that is now overtaking us as we all walk down the street staring at our phones, and how they take that to different levels and
to
such
different extremes.
Brilliant,
it's just so well done.
So
every
well done.
Episode is unique in its own way, And there are themes that run throughout the three seasons.
Correct.
And I will say, since it's a British show, the seasons are shorter. The episodes are a little longer. So the first season is three episodes, where the next season, the second season, is four. The third season is strictly, it's just six episodes.
Six episodes. Yeah. And the final show of the
six
is
almost
like
a two-hour film.
Two-hour film, yeah.
And that's a phenomenal episode.
It is a phenomenal episode.
I was captivated.
And I love the fact that our little Irish girl from
her.
Boardwalk Empire
She's great.
Was in this film.
She's fantastic.
She was so meek and so mild and
She's
such
perfect.
A sweet little Irish
girl. I really like her.
And the next thing you know, she's a hardcore detective.
She's great in this,
and she's very good, and she's very good.
That's
she's
the
wonderful.
Last episode of season three.
It is indeed.
Which
and I do hope that they...
They're going to do more. Because
I hope that they do
this
more.
This is a huge hit. They're going to have to do
it
another
It is. It's
one.
A wonderful show.
Yeah, and so anyway, long story short, we were going to touch a little bit on season two since we did one last
Let's
week.
Let's do that.
You know, so season two, the first episode focuses on a couple, a young couple. Mm. The stars of the episode are the band and the couple is Domhnall Gleeson, who is an actor who we've seen quite a bit of lately. He's the son of the actor Brendan Gleeson. He was in The Revenant. He was in The Force Awakens.
Yes.
He played the head of, I guess you could
He's
say, the
kind
Imperial
of the,
Forces.
The Imperial Force dictator kind of
yeah, yeah, exactly. And then
he's a red-haired man. He's also in El Machina.
He's in El Machina as well.
Yeah.
That's true. He is.
Yeah, he's in
Ex Machina, you mean.
Ex Machina.
Yeah, he's
El Machina.
He's really good.
El Machina.
Yes, he's got a subtleness
Macarena.
To him.
Macarena. Macarena.
God, that movie could have went in some weird directions.
Which
know?
One?
Ex Machina. If we did Macarena.
Oh,
Ex Machina.
Yeah. I know. That would have been wonderful.
Yes, and the female...
They all could have danced the Macarena.
Exactly. And the female in this episode is... oh my goodness.
Well, she's from The Shield.
The Shield, yeah.
It's Agents of Shield.
Agents of Shield.
It's a
and she was in the Captain America film.
She was in the Captain
Wait,
America
no, no, no,
film.
She's not in the, no, she's not in the Agents of Shield. She had her own show briefly, which I didn't think.
Oh, yeah.
Agent Carter.
Well, she has a show right now.
Is it still on the air, Agent
yes.
Carter? Okay.
Well,
which is a spinoff of the Captain America films.
She's a...
Haley Atwell is her name.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure.
She's a very luscious British gal.
She is.
I
buxom,
like her.
You could say.
She's very buxom.
Yeah.
But she's a great little actress,
she
too.
Is.
I really like her very much. I do.
No, she's good.
She's wonderful. Her husband... is that her husband or her boyfriend?
You know, it's not clear in this episode if they're married or if they're together as in a relationship. But
yeah.
They're domestic partners regardless. They're together as a couple.
Mm.
And then something happened. I really didn't even want to discuss too much of what happens, but... There's something...
Well, no, we can talk about what happens.
All right, well, if you don't want to know, guys, this could be seen as a spoiler, so you might want to tune out.
No, I don't think so.
No,
because
I went into it, I didn't know what was going to happen.
Yeah, but it happens very quickly.
Within 10 minutes.
Within 10 minutes of the film. We're not giving anything away. I just want to say, well, what happens is that her husband dies.
He dies,
now,
and it's all about how she deals with the grief.
Well, she deals with the grief, and then she finds out that there is a company that she can actually order... A replica of her husband.
Well, that's actually that's like step three in her grieving process. The first step is that you allow this company to you allow an app to be activated. That what it does is
that you can talk to him on the phone.
Think of it, of it as it's almost like a Google where everything that he ever did online, whether it be an email, social media. Phone
he
calls.
Reacts. It's actually like he's there talking to
it
her.
It sucks up everything he's ever done on the computer, and it allows her to interact with him via an automated voice on a phone, which first started out as an instant message kind of conversation.
It's
and
amazing.
And then the next evolution of this product, you could say, is they bring in artificial intelligence into her house where she orders, and she brings this basically robot to life, and it looks just like him, acts like him.
I'll tell you, that particular scene.
Creepy.
She gets a box in the mail. And it
Big
looks
box.
Like... And one thing I want to say about Black Mirror is that this film is not a generalized look at a media-driven nightmare world. It is always very personal.
Yeah.
We have very real kind of people that are in these shows, and they are real, they are honest, they have emotions like all of us. They are so well, the characters are so well rounded in this film. It's like
it's
we're
true.
Just seeing parts of ourselves in watching every single episode of this. That's why it's so captivating, is just the reality factor of the characters.
Well,
they bring it home every time.
Which, hence the title, Mirrors of It, but
Correct.
Black Mirror, where we're seeing the black screen. You know how, you know, we know what the reference is.
Well, sure, of course.
It's right there on
nice
the surface.
Nice little
it's really
thought
cool.
process. But anyway, she orders this box, yeah. And it is, in fact, it's like when we were all kids and we ordered, I mentioned this very
what they called space here, monkeys?
Little sea monkeys.
Sea monkeys,
we used to get these sea monkeys and we'd order them through the back of comic books or whatever, and you get them and they're just basically little funky things and they're dry. You throw them in water and they start to swim around. No, they become alive. It's a very bizarre thing, and that's exactly what happens. She orders this box, she opens it, and it's like an organic corpse.
It's very creepy.
It looks like a chicken, a plucked chicken almost. It just has that raw look to it. And she is now told to take these parts, this thing, and put it into water.
And then you got to add these little ingredients from a little baggie.
Yeah, it's like you're making a cappuccino.
And then eventually it will come to life.
It's amazing. And then suddenly, he expands, and there he is, her husband. He looks exactly like
that. Husband 2.0.
Exactly, 2.0.
Yeah. Bless you, my friend.
Pardon me. I hope he does. I hope the greater power blesses me.
Yes, he should.
But, one wonderful episode.
Yeah, and it's all about how their relationship evolves.
Yeah.
And can she come to love this like she did her husband?
Right.
You know, it's interesting.
He's not real.
Yeah.
He's not real, but he...
It's an episode about grief.
Acts. It's totally...
More than anything.
And I must say, I have had a grieving moment in my life. I lost my wife, but I cried through this whole episode. I could not possibly...
I was
told by another friend of mine, he said, this is going to be very hard for you to watch. And it was. I did.
Even for me, I've lost loved ones, but not a romantic partner in that sense.
Yeah, yeah.
But I can see how I would feel. I mean, I was touched by it. I mean, I wasn't crying
absolutely.
The whole time.
It was
a touching episode.
Absolutely moving.
You
know? The grief is so... I like the way sometimes she'll just be brushing her teeth and she'll crack up.
Yeah, exactly.
She'll just start laughing.
And that's how life
exactly
is.
How grief is.
Yeah.
One minute you're crying your eyes out, next minute you're laughing hilariously. You're just
something strikes you.
You know, we just memory is such an endearing and horrible thing at the same time, and it's all mixed together with the reality of real life. So you know, while you're remembering the bad things, or not the bad things, but the bad part of perhaps an illness that went south and so forth that possibly. You know, just basically went on to demise that particular person. You know, you're remembering good things too. And as
even
time
divorce,
goes on,
there are people that
absolutely.
Go through this.
As time goes on,
one side didn't want the divorce.
Forgive my
know?
Sputtering around and not being able to voice myself.
It's
properly
fine.
Here.
It's
I apologize.
Your point is made. And
but my point is made. And there you go. Great episode. Great.
Yeah.
Maybe we should just leave.
Well, I was just going to say, in the interest of time, why don't we jump to flashback and we'll continue season two's discussion next week.
We'll continue season
because it's
two
a short
discussion
season.
Next week. And for those of you who are very upset that I haven't used the megaphone this week.
You used it briefly.
I did use it briefly, but I just want to use it again. Just one last time as we go into the final roundup of the show.
Yes.
All right, and here we go. It's now time for flashback.
I know, that's horrible, though. I know. Okay,
why don't you go first?
You want me to go first?
Yeah.
Well, what's your flashback show?
I'm thinking about it still.
Oh, you haven't
I'm debating.
Come up with it.
Well, no, I'm debating what I want to do. Why don't you go first?
All right, my flashback film, something none of you have probably seen. It's the Best Actress Oscar winner of 1965, none other than the beautiful Miss Julie Christie, who, if you are over the age of 40 or 50, you're going to love Julie because she is the epitome of posh, young, British beauty. And she is just lovely, and she's darling, quite bluntly. And this is about a movie, and it's directed by the brilliant Mr. John Schlesinger, who gave us Day of the Locust, but more significantly gave us the wonderful Midnight Cowboy, Best Picture, 1969, John Boyd, Dustin Hoffman. Hey, I'm walking here. I'm walking here.
He might have done Pacific Heights, which I love. Was that him?
No.
Was it him?
I don't think so.
I think it might have been.
You're talking Michael Keaton and Melanie Griffith?
I love that movie. Matthew Modine? That's a great film.
Yeah.
It was either him or what was that guy's name? Harold Becker? I'll tell you in a second. But continue your review.
I believe it was Schlesinger. It's very possible. But I'm sorry if it was, but because John is a great director.
Well, that was a good film, though, Pacific Heights. I mean, it's not an Oscar movie, but it's a fun...
Well, I'll tell you,
movie.
I like European cinema quite a bit, and I love stuff like La Dolce Vita.
John Schlesinger, I knew it.
All right, good for you.
1990.
All right, the man knows his movies.
I
That's why he's sitting here next to me.
That's true.
And that's the truth. And
you know what? I'm going to do that as my flashback because it's a great segue.
All right.
I love that film.
There you go.
But continue.
Okay. This movie has such a European feel to it. Schlesinger just captured that whole Fellini kind of look. That it almost has a documentary feel. Dirk Bogarde is in this movie. I love this movie. I had never seen it before. I never wanted to see it. I was never really interested in... it's about a woman who basically just uses men as a stepping stone and basically sleeps her way to the top.
Okay.
And then just keeps on going and going and going. And then, of course, memory kicks in and she kind of wants to go back to the way things were with certain guys. But men are just stepping stones for her. And I love this movie.
Sounds great.
I was totally enraptured by it. It's 2 hours and 6 minutes
long. Sounds like a great performance film.
A great performance film.
I'm gonna check it out.
Julie Christie also, the same year that this came out, she was had a major role in David Lean's Dr. Zhivago.
Okay, yeah.
But she was not even nominated for Dr. Zhivago. And I almost think Dr. Zhivago is a better performance because she, it's a David Lean movie and she's... plays Lara. That's my mandolin impression,
like
by the way. And I'm playing Lara's theme by Maurice Jarre, who won an Oscar for that film. But there we go. So, I love the movie. It's just black and white. It's just strong. Oh, I loved it. It was good. It's just British, and everybody is talking, oh, darling, oh, do make me a martini, please. And... oh, right, and we'll sit at the grand piano and play. Oh, yes, darling, let's. It's wonderful. And the use of the word darling
is very common, sure, throughout the film.
It's quite the parody of real life. And
great.
And she's a fashionista. She's a fashion model, etc.
And your flashback. Well, you know what, in the interest of time, I'm going to just speed through this because we're really, really running low on time. I'm going to do Pacific Heist, like I said. It's a 1993. Film, the thriller by John Schlesinger.
Okay.
Schlesinger. It's a tongue. My tongue can't do it right now.
It's easy for you.
Exactly. All right. The film. Matthew Modine and Melanie Griffith decide to. They're a married couple, and they want to have a rental property, which they want to use as an investment as well.
Right.
So they buy this beautiful old house in the hills of San Francisco.
Ah.
In the house, there's a couple. There's three basically apartments. They live in the top floor. The bottom floor is split between two little apartments. One they rent to a nice little Asian couple, and the other apartment they rent to a single man played by Michael Keaton.
Okay.
And he seems okay at first when after they spend all this money renovating this beautiful old home, he moves in and basically becomes the nightmare from hell tenant,
which
slowly destroys this apartment and then just kind of tries to destroy their life.
Right.
And they can't do much about it because California is famous for its laws that really, really side with the tenant over the person who owns the property.
Ah, interesting.
And this is something that's common. It's almost epidemic in some areas of California.
I did not know.
It makes it very hard to evict somebody. And the whole movie, he is a terror to them.
Right.
And throughout the film, they discover more and more about him as they try to figure out who this guy is.
Interesting.
And how to get rid of him.
I saw the film.
A dynamite performance by Michael Keaton in this film.
Yeah, he's wonderful.
Who's frightening in this movie.
Yeah, he is.
It's a great film.
I don't know if he's frightening.
He plays a bad guy. He does
very
a great job.
Yeah.
He does it very well.
He does.
For him, it's always in the eyes, in the tone of his voice.
Absolutely.
It's great. And so,
I'm Batman.
Anyway, so check out Pacific Heights if you can. If you catch it on HBO, definitely worth checking out. It might be on Netflix.
As is Darling.
Yeah.
A recap. You love Miss Sloane?
I love Miss Sloane. Go check it out. Manchester by the Sea?
I liked it very, very much. I was very moved by it.
Excellent
film. It was a tearjerker. It was very
film.
Well done. Yeah.
Rupture.
Which I did
check
last
it out.
Week.
Really horrifying.
Such a bizarre
great performance
film.
By
so
Nomi
Rapace. Bizarre.
Yeah.
I got to mention also Michael Chiklis.
He's in that too. Peter Stormare as well.
I know.
Film.
Yeah, very bizarre. So strange. Next film was, of course, Hardcore Henry.
Yeah, Hardcore Henry. And then Light Between Oceans.
Big down for Hardcore.
But it's worth checking out once at the very least.
Yeah,
it's an exciting movie.
If your brain can handle just wanting to puke for an entire...
but not everybody
has
that
It's almost a two-hour film. It's almost 2 hours.
It's less.
Not much less.
Really?
It felt like... I think it's like an hour and 47
minutes. If you're feeling
minutes.
Crappy during the movie, you're going to feel it.
I felt horrible through the whole film, pretty much.
And then you did The Disappointment Room?
Then I did The... No, then I did Pet.
Okay.
With Dominic Monaghan, right, from the
Lord of the
Rings
films.
And you'll recognize Dominic. I wish we had photographs to show
you.
Just
eventually we will evolve
Eventually
I want a screen back here.
Yeah, maybe we'll become Black Mirror.
Yes.
And not only will we have, we'll have the actual person here via hologram.
That would be cool.
Yeah, via hologram, we'll have Dominic Monaghan
maybe
sitting right here.
Godspeed.
Yeah, there you go.
Okay, and then you did Disappointments Room with Kate Beckinsale?
I did. I never did do Devil's Dolls.
We don't have time.
We don't have time?
No.
Okay. Okay,
yeah.
So the battery's going to die on the camera, so we got to go.
Thanks for telling us.
So there we go. All right, folks.
But we really enjoyed episode 13. Hope you did too.
I did too.
We'll be back next week, episode 14.
I'll be back because I got nothing else to do. You know what I'm saying?
Hey, you know what? This is the highlight of the week. For I love it. I really love doing this.
Me too, too.
And I'm glad everybody keeps coming back to watch us every week because we really get a kick out of doing this.
We really do.
Yeah.
Okay. Very good. And apparently 50 of you thought we were okay. And,
yeah, hey, that's great. 124 of you were watching, so that's great. Yeah.
Man, we love you. We're so
and,
grateful.
And next week, catch the Rogue so One grateful. Edition. We will be reviewing Rogue One at the top of the hour.
My little friend sitting
Little
there.
Monkey Shines.
A little Monkey Shines.
This thing is really disturbing me.
It is a very disturbing little thing, but it is from the film Monkey Shines, which was an old George Romero film. Actually, from years
that's
and
creepy.
Years ago. It is
really horrifying.
It is really
but
creepy.
He is not plush.
I think he's missing an eye. He is missing an eye.
Horrifying.
Yeah, yeah. He is missing an eye, but he's very near and dear to me, and
it's
I love
not,
him
it's
very
It's not
much.
One of your other sons, is it?
No, it's not. He's no relation to me whatsoever.
All right. Well, but thank anyway, you for sharing that with us.
Thank you. You're so welcome.
And everybody, we will see you next week.
We'll see you next week.
Rogue
thank
One
so
Edition.
Much.
Don't forget, we're going to
yes,
see
yes.
Rogue One.
Rogue
we're
One.
Gonna,
everybody go see Rogue One.
Everybody will.
Everybody will.
And my gut tells me it's going to be better than Force Awakens, and that's what the reviews are saying.
Well, it supposedly
bit.
Is on the darker side.
Oh, yeah. It's going to be. It's a war film. They said we're tackling it. The filmmakers were tackling it as a war film. So that's exciting.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that is
that's
cool.
That's going to be cool.
Yeah,
it's
yeah,
going to be
yeah.
awesome. I'm
and
really excited.
Special effects in the Star Wars movie.
It's going to be amazing.
I love The Force Awakens. I
did too. I loved it too.
I just watched it in 3D the other night.
That was the film
oh my God.
I didn't think we were ever going to get.
You know,
and let's touch on
it
next week a little bit.
Okay. Yeah. We shall indeed.
But anyway, guys,
very
thank
good.
You so much for watching. Sorry we got to run. But we had a great time tonight.
As I said to two military
you.
Ladies that I saw at Taco Bell yesterday, I said to them as I left, I said, carry on.
Very nice.
And I say that to you. So good night.
Bid you all adieu.